a gold ring and a lock of your hair, and a card with your picture upon it. It's a face that it's false, but it's fair. Oh, I'll pawn you my gold watch and chain, love, and I'll pawn you my gold wedding ring. I'll pawn this heart in my bosom. Cheer my poor heart. This old world would seem sad to love without you. Tell me now that we're never to part. Oh, I'll pawn you my gold watch and chain, love, and I'll pawn you my gold wedding ring. Oh, I'll pawn you this heart in my bosom. Only say been growing there for a while. It broke through on the day that I met you. It will die on the day when you smile.
Oh, I'll pawn you my gold watch and chain, love, and I'll pawn you my gold wedding ring. Oh, I'll pawn you this heart in my bosom.
Thank you. Thank you so very much. Listen, you're really sweet to me. Thank you. It's just such a thrill for me to have the opportunity to be here and be hosting the show for you tonight. I think my husband, Johnny Cash, is my husband. He's my husband because he's handy. But he's not here tonight. I wish he was. You never can tell when he shows up, though. So I'm just kind of missing him being down here. But we've got a great show lined up for you. And so I've just got one thing to say to John, if you're watching at home. Take out the garbage. Okay. Tonight, our show features some really nice folks that I think you're going to enjoy. It's been a long time since I've had the opportunity to work with my sister, Helen Carter. She's here with her son, David Carter Jones. And then my daughter, who is going to sing for you tonight, Rosie Carter, is here, and I think you'll enjoy them. We have John McEwen, who I dearly love, from the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band, a great friend that was a good friend of my mother's when she was alive. And then we are going to give to you Freddie Powers tonight that we've borrowed from our old friend Merle. And we'll see about that in a little bit, in just a minute. Thank you. You know, in the beginning of country and western music, there was just a simple kind of a little sound that some people used to call the Carter Scratch. And that started way back in the 1920s with my mother, Maybelle Carter, Uncle A.P., and Aunt Sarah. And there was a lot of those great old Carter family songs, but that simple little kind of music we call the Carter Scratch is still around today, and it's hardly ever I get a chance to work with my sister Helen, and she plays that so much like Mother used to, and her son David Carter Jones is here, and we'll do you one of the old Carter family, just back to the basic kinds of country music, and hope that you enjoy You Are My Flower. Helen, this is up to you.
Just as blue. The day is just as bright, the birds are singing too. You are my flower, that's blooming in the mountain for me. are my flower that's blooming there for me. Sunlight just as free, and nature seems to say it's all for you and me. You are my flower that's blooming in the mountain for me. You are my flower that's blooming there for me. Begins to fall. Just sing this song and say to one and all, you are my flower that's blooming in the mountain for me. You are my flower that's blooming there for me.
I'm telling you, that's really fun to kind of go back to the way it started out a long, long time ago. And this is unusual for me. I'm probably the biggest blabbermouth in country and Western music. But it's unusual for me to get to sit and talk and interview my sister and my nephew here. Yeah. And Helen, I might ask you and David kind of, both of you, what's happening to you nowadays since I don't see so much of you?
Well, we've been working some, we're glad to say. I'm working some with David, and I've got another son, Kevin, who works with us, and we like to get out and meet the folks every once in a while. We enjoy it, doing the old things and the new.
Well, David, you're doing some new stuff too, aren't you?
Yeah, I've been doing a lot of, I try to write some, you know, my original material. I try to stay after that, but I'm still trying to learn the traditional stuff too, still trying to stay with that.
I'm still trying to learn just anything that comes along.
You and me too.
Hitting it from any direction that I can. Well, I go one way with the old golden-throated one, and Helen, she has the farm down in Dixon, Tennessee, so I don't get to see my family as much as I'd like to, and it's going to be really nice tonight because this is kind of a family type kind of thing we've got here with Helen and David and Rosie here and John McEwen being here.
I know.
And then whoever else is liable to show up, and we may all get really excited about who's going to show up before the night is over. It's all kind of a family type thing. If you're not a little bit Carter family, you will be before the night's over, so
that's
you can
right.
get ready for that.
That's very true.
We're looking forward to that. Now, the reason that I'm blabbing so much is because poor old puny Ralph Emery has gone on a vacation. And he's off somewhere, laid back like a big hog. And I'm the
You're
one
working.
That's here. Ralph, if you knew what I went through, you don't know how close I come to not getting on the show. See, there was a skirt that went to what I've got on. But I got the zipper hung on it, so we had to kind of rip it off of me, and I've got on the same color pair of pants, but I was going to look real sexy for this show.
You were
so
planning.
I have to make an announcement right now.
That's it.
This is as sexy as I'm going to get. Oh, my goodness. Well, that's the way it is. Well, Helen, let's see. Are you writing any lately?
I'm trying. I'm writing some along. I'm hoping I can keep my hand in a little bit. I don't write quite as much as I did, though.
Well, we're going to be hearing a lot more from David soon, because I've heard some of that new album that you cut, David, and all we got to do now is just see when it comes
just
out.
I'd like to see.
Y'all don't get to see any of that tonight, but we will be right back in a few minutes, and you're going to meet my daughter, Rosie Carter, in just a few minutes. Do you know, when they called me up about doing this show, they asked me if I'd come out and host Nashville Now for Ralph, and I said I was just only too glad to do that. I've been on here just talking to him, and they asked me what I would like to do, and I was talking about my family and stuff, and I figured I had enough daughters in this business to finally get around to asking one of them to sing on the show. I spoke to our daughter, Roseanne Cash, this morning. Roseanne had to go to New York, so she couldn't be here. I talked to our daughter, Carlene Carter, and she lives in London and has just barely made it back to Los Angeles. But the chances of a young girl or a daughter or even a son making it in this business, they're mighty slim. And we're awfully proud of Roseanne Cash and what has happened to her, and of Carlene too, Carlene being in the play in London and all. And we got another daughter that you might have seen somewhere. She used to come on the road with us quite a bit, and when we first started, I had two little pipey voices singing behind Johnny Cash and I, and one of them was Roseanne Cash, and the other one, it's interesting, we'll go into this, that we have two, we have a Rosanna and we have a Roseanne. And this is Rosanna, only we call her Rosie, and she's just chosen to be a Carter instead of a Cash, so here's Rosie Carter for you in a song that she wrote called Pardon My Moods.
Quiet evening at home, slipping deeper and believing that I've always been alone. Some voice insisting on the telephone.
Just
really be interesting.
I don't know how to interview a daughter. Maybe you can tell me something about yourself that I don't already know.
I don't know where to start.
Well, let's see. You've got several years to make up here, and since this is kindly the beginning of Rosie, even though she's been singing for a while and writing for a while, this your Nashville now is kind of the starting of maybe you're trying to get started in the music business. So tell us what you want to do and what you've been doing and what you got on your mind. You want to do that? That'll take you about 12 weeks.
Well, I really have been writing a lot with a good friend of mine, and I'm trying to get a lot of songs cut right now. And I'm out there pushing real hard. We just got a Waylon Jennings cut, which just happened to be the one I sang. So,
well, let's go.
Yeah, that made me pretty happy, too.
Yeah, that would make me happy. I'd like to have a cut by Waylon Jennings, too, if you could manage to get me one. Rosie and I wrote a song one time. We never got it cut. I cut it, and it never went any further than the office at House of Cash.
It sure should have, though.
I know
it. You remember?
Gatsby's Restaurant.
Yeah. Gatsby's Restaurant.
My mom took me into New York City, and I was very, how you say, not used to New York City. And we went into this restaurant. I thought it was just like any ordinary restaurant, but there was little dark-headed people running all over the place. I think it's the way it's looked anyway. So we went and wrote a song called Gatsby's Restaurant. It was really neat.
Yeah, I thought it was cute.
I thought it was
you
great.
You want to sing it, or you want me to?
I want you to.
You do. Well, I don't know if I remember it or not. It got to, let's see.
One line is, there's a petrified Italian with escargot in his hair.
I remember that one. It went, well, I got tired of New York City with its sidewalks and its streets, and I got myself
a big white horse,
and I rode him down the street. Mm-hmm. And then I hollered, "Hi-ho, Silver, and get him up, Scout," and I slid into Gatsby's restaurant with his tail sticking out.
No, with his tail stuck in my mouth.
He's rewriting it.
Yeah.
No. I knew I had it wrong. What was it?
It's with his tail stuck in my mouth.
And I remember the chorus went to, but you don't ride a big white horse into
to the front of Gatsby's door,
and you don't
yell out, "I hold Silver," as you scoot across the floor.
I had 20 big Italians had me bent down on my knees, and I said, oh
ouch, and helping Lord Mamma Mia, please.
Well, that was a lot
that
of
fun.
Yeah.
That was good.
That was a pretty good one. Maybe you'd record that one when you get down to
sure
it.
Sure will, boy.
Do that one a try. We'll be right back in just a minute with John McEwen after this.
There's more country coming at you live from Music City on Nashville Now. You're watching the Nashville Network.
Our next guest will be appearing in concert August the 25th in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And he will appear with the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band August the 30th at the Colorado State Fair. And this is a good friend of ours and of everybody's and country music and all over. Any kind of music here from the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band is our good friend, John McEwen.
Thank you. Thank you. This is a story about a couple guys called the Johnson Boys. Johnson boys are raised in the ashes, didn't know how to court a maid. turned their backs and hid their faces. Sight of a pretty girl made them afraid. Sight of a pretty girl made them afraid. Johnson boys went to the city riding in that Chevrolet. They came back both broken walking. Had no money for to pay their way. Had no money for to pay their way. Now the Johnson boys were afraid of women like some guys are. So every time they'd see them coming, they'd start running. And every time they'd start running a little bit faster because they didn't want to get caught. They ran like this. So we're going to speed it up on the dancers a little bit at a time and turn it into a little aerobic bluegrass. Stay with me now.
It's about time that we got on a television screen or on a show together, don't you think?
I think so, too, yeah.
I'm really thrilled to see you.
Well, it's been a while since I saw you. I think the last time was Ogden, Utah, probably.
Yeah, it seemed to me like I remember you showing up backstage, and then all of a sudden you were a part of what we were. You want to talk about it?
Well, yeah, it was fun. I was flying in. I lived in Salt Lake for a couple years. Boy, that was fun. Well, I did too. Yeah. That's why I moved away, I guess. wanted to keep it special. I was coming in from being on the road, and I ran into your whole troupe. Yeah. And Marty Stewart yelled out at me. I was in my normal days, walking through an airport, carrying my banjo, kind of. And Marty said, "Hey, come on over here." And you guys were all over there, and said, "Come on up to Ogden and play." So I came up, and it was really quite an honor just to be on stage with you guys. It was really a big moment to me to be sitting in on the Cash show. And then Marty came up to me after the show and said, "You know, we've only had two other people sit in, a 10-year-old boy and a drunk hobo."
Well, I tell you what, you've been special to us for many reasons, but the most reason was you were really special to Mother Maybelle Carter.
Well, that was thank you.
Yeah, and tonight when you were coming, and I know you thought about it and I thought about it, we all thought about, I wonder will we have to sing Will the Circle Be Unbroken? So I told John, "Don't you dare sing Will the Circle Be Unbroken?" And he told me, "Don't you dare sing it." So we decided not to do that.
We made a pact.
We made a pact.
Circle Be Unbroken is kind of the Louie Louie of bluegrass music.
Well, that's absolutely right.
Well,
no, I tell you,
ended my career in country music, I
guess. No, I tell you, we sing it all the time. We love to sing it, and I said it would be the thing they would expect us to sing with you, being here with all these Carter group. And
well, how that came about with us is the Dirt Band had the proud honor of being part of a record that my brother and the band put together called "Will the Circle Be Unbroken?" And I think they have some pictures here I'd like
yes,
to show.
Yes, I think that's terrific. If
about
we could just see some of these
15
pictures.
15 years ago, we spent some time in the studio to make this album, and we found ourselves in Woodland Studios here in Nashville, 1971, I believe it was. Go to the next picture, please. Click. And this is the bunch of guys. Next picture, please. Click. Yeah, I can do that. That's Jim Ibbotson and Jeff Hanna and Roy Acuff. Now, we were always getting people asking us, "We heard Roy didn't want to work with you." Well, Roy was more curious about our hair than our music, I think, at the time. And he said, "I don't know if those are young boys or old men or what. Their hair's so long." And you can see young Jeff Hanna there looks a lot older than he does now. Mm-hmm. And in the next picture, you see Maybelle, and Merle Travis is there in the middle playing the guitar. For those of you that aren't familiar with Merle Travis, he invented a style of guitar playing called Chet Atkins style. And that's Jeff Hanna on the right, and Bashful Brother Oswald in the background. We're getting ready to do You Are My Flower right there, as a matter of fact.
Right there.
And the next picture shows Maybelle and us getting ready to do with Doc Watson. I believe this is Circle Be Unbroken. And you can always see us sitting at Maybelle's feet, because we felt like we were in church when we were around her.
Well, that's really sweet of you to say that. I guess we felt that way all of our lives.
What's the next picture show us? And this is, that's the same picture, isn't it?
No, it's just Mother from Another Direction and Merle, I think.
We're trying to figure out, one of my favorite things that Maybelle said in that whole session, we were getting ready to do Wildwood Flower, and she goes, I'm going to do this in B flat if it's okay with y'all. And you know, Maybelle, you wrote the song. The whole reason you're here is to do it. You're asking us what key, you know, you want us to do it in. And she was always like that. A real good lesson in humility. And here we are doing I Saw the Light or Circle Be Unbroken. That's Earl Scruggs on the left. No, this is You Are My Flower. Mm-hmm. Maybelle's playing the auto harp. And Jim Ibbotson and me over there sitting in. And it was really quite one of the best experiences in our musical career, I think.
Well, that's so sweet of you to say that. I tell you, we were really proud of that. Proud of that. Thank you.
You know, we did a show with Maybelle and David in Lexington, Kentucky. Now, the Dirt Bands had a strange career, because sometimes we'd be on a rock and roll show because we had records in the pop charts occasionally, and they'd say, "What's that bluegrass band doing here?" You know, and then we go play a bluegrass festival, and they'd say, "What's that rock and roll band doing here?"
Yeah.
Well, the night after we played with Aerosmith, we found ourselves in Lexington, Kentucky, on a show with Doc Watson and Maybelle Carter, and David was playing in the band, and the Carter girls were backing him up. He sat in with us.
Loved it.
But
I think Carlene was there too.
Yeah, the whole
lonesome fiddle. Yeah.
You were there.
I was there. Rosie was there. Lori was there. Roseanne was there. Morgantown, West Virginia is where all the girls.
And something Maybelle told me I'll never forget, because she always had trouble with the auto harp, kind of. I mean, Maybelle would stand like 5 feet from the mic, you know, and then she'd kind of move up a little bit. Yeah, you push on. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I asked her, I said, "Does the microphone ever give you guys problems?" And she said, "Well, I told the girls one time if that mic ever gave them any trouble, just smile real loud."
Well, that's like Mama.
Yeah.
Thank you, John. I tell you, we'll be right back after this. At home to get ready now, because we're going to be taking your phone calls in just a few minutes here. The number is 1-800-821-6020. And as always, we've got that cute little trivia question for you. And tonight we're going to give away one of these good old Nashville belt buckles right here, Nashville Network. And here's tonight's trivia question. Name the two people who wrote the Johnny Cash hit song Ring of Fire. Okay, you think on that for a minute and then you give us your calls. Well, ordinarily, when you're listening to the Carter family, you're listening to myself, my sister Helen, our sister Anita. And tonight, Anita wasn't feeling well at all and actually was put to bed by her doctor and wasn't able to get here. And she has that lovely high voice that I was trying to figure out who in the world was going to help us out at a time like this. And I called a special friend of mine, because this man really is a special person. And he's been a great friend to us for a long time, but I never dreamed. He said to me, "I'll just come down and give you a hand." And this is a real surprise to everybody in the audience and who's watching tonight too. And we're all really looking forward to this, because it's going to be something really unusual, I think. Here is Merle Haggard. Listen, you made me really happy. I'd just like to sit here on your front row and let you talk a while.
All right, well, I can tell you who wrote that song right off the bat.
Well, let me get I may Is there any way he can get this? Can I give this to him?
You and Merle Kilgore wrote that song.
All right, Ear Haggard. I'm sorry, all you folks at home, forget it. Haggard, you're a real buddy to come down and be with us tonight, really. I know that this is going to thrill Anita more than you'll ever know, because I know she can't think of anybody that she'd rather have here than you.
Well, there was a time in the past, I forget how many years ago, won't bring that up.
Let's don't talk about that, how many years ago.
Yeah, that I called the Carter family and asked them to come down to a little church in Memphis, Tennessee. A little church called Big Creek Baptist Church. We was doing an album down there called A Land of Many Churches.
Yeah, terrific album.
And I called the Carter family and asked them if they'd come down.
And we did.
You did.
And you said we didn't have to rehearse. We already knew the songs and we'd done them cold. I remember that. But it was fun. It was beautiful.
Well, I've been waiting all those years to pay you back for that favor.
Well, Haggard, we're thrilled to death. We couldn't have thought of anybody that we'd rather have here than you.
Well, I understand Johnny's daddy's not
well. Yeah, he's not too well.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Grandpa Cash he's had pneumonia and he's feeling a little bit better now, but John is with Grandpa Cash tonight. Yeah. He'll be thrilled that you've come too. And I don't know how we can have Merle Haggard without asking Merle to grab a guitar and do something. You can sing or dance. Sing, Merle.
This is I'm not familiar with this lady here.
I don't know who that one is. I've got mine. That's somebody else's.
Here, you go ahead and give that to somebody else.
I will.
I don't need that.
Make up a name who wrote Ring of Fire.
Okay.
Just as long as you get mine on the other end of it. You're just like Mother Maybelle. She used to tune in Carnegie Hall. We would be playing Carnegie Hall, and twice we had to stand and there and wait while Mother just tuned her guitar.
If you get to Carnegie Hall, you better tune it.
You better tune. That's right.
Oh, I'll never swim Kern River again. Hold it.
If you're in Nashville now, you better get in tune too, Merle.
Well, I'll tell you what, we may have to give up on this.
Wait a minute, let me
guitar.
Give you my guitar.
Here, have that guitar.
You
over.
Like this one? Mine's that one over there, that pretty one. I don't know anything about this one.
Well,
this one's all whopper-jawed and round in the back and got holes in it.
That's one of them standing ovations there.
Yeah.
See that?
Uh-huh. If that one don't work, I'll get you mine. Mine's
okay.
Really pretty.
See the difference?
Yeah.
Gosh.
That's terrific.
Do you know any longer songs?
Longer songs?
Longer than I'll ever swim Kern River again.
That was short.
Oh, I'll never swim Kern River again. It was there that I met her. It was there that I lost my best friend. Now I live in the mountains. I drifted up here with the wind. And I may drown in still water, but I'll never swim Kern River again.
Oh. You're not going to quit on us, are you?
You told me I was just going to have to talk if I come.
I know it, but you're here and you've got that voice with you wherever you go. What do you expect me to ask you to do?
I'd like
I mean, Haggard, it's... You're just one of those people that has that voice that people love to hear.
Well,
and they're not through listening. I mean, you can't just sing us a piece of a song. Don't you know a whole song?
Sing one.
Sing a whole one, Merle.
A whole song?
Yeah.
Now you got me. I've been doing pieces of them. I grew up in an old town where my gusher never came in. And the river was a boundary where my darling and I used to swim. One night in the moonlight, the swiftness swept her life away. Now I live on Lake Shasta, and Lake Shasta is where I will stay. There's the South San Joaquin, where the seeds of the Dust Bowl are found. And there's a place called Mount Whitney, from where the mighty Kern River comes down. Well, it's not deep nor wide, but it's a mean piece of water, my friend. And I may cross on the highway, but I'll never swim Kern River again. Oh, I'll never swim Kern River again. So forth, and I forgot the words, so anyway. There's a lot of my friends out there that know I never can remember the words, so I can't disappoint all my friends.
No, it's time for you. Well, every once in a while you have to stop and swallow, Merle.
That's true. Very true.
Yeah, that's what I do when I don't know the words. You just say, hold on now while I swallow.
I just make up other words and put other words in there. Sometimes they don't know all the words. The audience, you know, sometimes doesn't know the songs they come to hear. I luck out.
Yeah, that's good. That's terrific. Well, Mr. Haggard, I tell you, I've been reading about you in the paper.
Have you?
Yeah, I've been reading about you all over.
Was it an old paper?
No, it was. No, I think we're through with that. No, I mean, somebody said to me the other day, they said, I hear Merle Haggard got married. And I said, did he marry the right one? And I just found out that you married the right one.
I certainly did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm thrilled.
Very happy.
Yeah.
Very happy.
I'm glad.
That's unusual for me to be very happy.
That's what I was going to say. That ain't your style, Merle.
I'm not talking about style at all, but I really am.
You're going to have to write a happy kind of song now.
Yeah.
Have you written her any happy songs?
Well, I've written some songs last few days. We've been thinking about the farmer.
Yeah.
Doing farm songs. We're fixing to do an album called the Amber Fields of Grain.
Oh, yeah.
And I can do a little bit, I guess, for you right now.
Great.
Let's see. If the amber fields of grain may fade away, and see, I forgot the words of that.
I mean, that's shorter than the other one, Merle.
Let me try again. No, wait a minute. Let me get this. If the amber waves of grain may disappear, and there'd be no wheat or barley anywhere, would we buy our bread and butter from Toyota Man? Would an Idaho spud be stamp made in Japan?
Now, that was short, but that was a mouthful. I'm proud of you, Merle. That's going to be fine. You're going to record that, then?
We're going to do a thing that's it's kind of dedicated to the slogan, Buy American, and also to the appealing to the country to look inward and try to help the farmers. And I'm kind of tired of Beirut and hearing about El Salvador and all them places down there. I'd like to see if I could just say something or sing something that might make the American public just look inward
for a
few minutes.
I tell you what, we'll be right back after this and we'll look in. Thank you.
my favorite country right there.
It's terrific to be talking with Merle Haggard and John McEwen, and of course the Carter family. All of us are around here. And Haggard, you know, I'd like to ask you to do something for me. I've asked you to do a lot since you've been out here these last few minutes, and I'm really leaning on you tonight because I think you've got somebody that you could probably introduce and know more about than I do. I was going to put him on the show tonight because I've always loved him, but he's closer to you than he is to me, and I'd like for maybe you to tell the people about him and introduce him for us.
Well, this is my running buddy. We've been writing songs together for the last 5-6 years, and I think we've had several number ones.
Songs that we've written together.
Mm-hmm. And now he's signed with MCA and he's fixing to start his own artist career. And I don't think he's any stranger to Nashville now. But I'd like you to make welcome Freddie Powers, ladies and gentlemen.
They told us that we never reach the top. They said that we would probably not. But we rode a bolt of lightning through the sky. You and I, we're riding high. You and I,
good to have you here. That's terrific. Oh, I get to get kissed. It's really tickly to get kissed with somebody with a beard like that. That's terrific. Enjoyed that. Freddie, that's your new record, is that right?
It's my brand new record. Yeah. Just came out.
On only MCA.
Pretty good pickers you got there.
I tell you what. That's Dean Reynolds on the bass and Clint Strong on the guitar. Both a couple of Texas boys.
Well, they hit me right along. You know, Freddie, you go most everywhere Haggard goes. I think most of the time the both of you are together wherever you go and when you're doing things. And what you said a minute ago, Merle, this would involve both of you because I know your heart, both of you have your heart in the same place. And you're talking to John and I and all of us about the farmers and what you're thinking about and the trip that you're going to make across the United States in support of the farmers. You want to tell us a little bit about that, Merle?
Well, it's our plans to take a train from Bakersfield, California, which is the southern end of the farming community there, to Champaign, Illinois, where we're going to join some more people that's involved with the armed crisis situation. Willie Nelson and I think the Beach Boys, Waylon's going to be there.
Yeah.
And I understand Bob Dylan's going to be there, and probably some people that I haven't mentioned. And we're going to do several intermediate stops between Bakersfield and Payne and appeal to the American public for the farmer and in behalf of the Buy American slogan, and also in behalf of maybe fixing some of the railroads around the country in case we really had some problems and needed some, to ship some soldiers across this country.
That's right.
You know, they there's a lot of money being spent on defense, but I haven't seen anything done with the rusty railroad tracks. And I remember the last time we had a war 40 years ago, it took a lot of trains to get some soldiers across this country. I don't think we could fly them all there right now. So if we needed to go somewhere, we might need to have a railroad.
Well, you know, Haggard, I think that's great that you're going to take your train, and if there's anywhere along the line that I could catch it, I'd like to get on it somewhere myself. I don't quite know what our schedule is or anything, but I, for one, have always loved the farmers. I was raised on a farm, weren't you?
My daddy was a farmer, and they moved to town before I was born, but that's all I ever heard about. And then I went back to the farm when I was growing up. I earned my first dollar on a farm.
Yeah,
and
I did too.
So I have been around it all my life, and mainly I'm just really concerned with there's two or three main problems in this country that seems like we're just continually overlooking. You know, there's a lot of things that need to be said in behalf of the farmer and people that the free enterprise in this country.
Well, I think so too, Haggard, and we're thrilled to have you say what you think, and we'll go to the phones right after this, and we'll be,
No, thank you. She said it. I was, John Carter and I were watching the show, you know, and she told me to carry out the garbage, and I thought I didn't know where to carry the garbage. I never have done that. Be right back.
Best view of country in the country. Stay tuned. There's more coming up live on the Nashville Network.
Well, I tell you what, I'm sorry, but we've run out of time for the phone, so y'all don't get to call tonight. Just forget it. We're just going to have them tomorrow night, and what we're going to do is just let you and Haggard talk and everybody else that has something to say.
My brother Tommy brought me. Tommy brought
Tommy
me down
Cash.
Here.
Tommy
Where's
Cash.
Tommy Cash?
Yeah, Tommy, we're really glad to have you here.
Good to see you,
camera.
Well, I had just come in from the pond, and the fish were really biting, and everything was so peaceful. John Carter and I watching TV, and he was cleaning the fish, because I don't know how. And then you announced that I should carry out the garbage, and I didn't know where to take the garbage. Because I never have done that.
No.
Have you, Merle?
No, I didn't do it today.
I've made a lot of the garbage, but I never did have to take it out.
He's the king of the garbage makers right here.
Well, I carried out my last bag of groceries when I rode Okie from Muskogee.
Well, that will enable you to do it, too. I knew if you saw Haggard on here that you would just waltz right on down here because you're good friends. I'm glad to see
here.
You didn't
I
know.
Didn't know he was on
you didn't
here.
Know he was here yet. He was bringing the garbage. Haggard?
Well, this is true.
Oh.
I thought
well,
you'd come
see.
Me.
We'll find out
came
where
along.
To put
I'm
it.
Glad I got to see you. I came a long way, though. It took us 45 minutes to get here. But I'm glad to see everybody. I'm a fan of the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band.
You know, Freddie Powers, John.
Yeah. Freddie. And Rosie, you sing yet?
Yes, sir.
Good
yeah,
girl.
You were on the road coming down here when she was singing.
Good.
Good. So,
great. Yeah. Thanks.
No, I mean, good.
What can
can you do? What, with help like that, you can.
No.
You know, I told
you. You look good.
Thank you. You do too.
Thank you.
You know, there's one thing we could get straightened out for Rosie right now. This happens every time Rosie gets it. Not every time Rosie gets on something, but I talked to Roseanne this morning. Yesterday when it was in the paper, they said Rosie Cash was going to be here, and I said, whoa, wait a minute. We've got to get this straightened out. In our family, we've got a Roseanne Cash that is our oldest daughter that does a wonderful job singing, and then we've got Rosanna. And this is Rosanna, only we call her Rosie. So it's Rosie Carter and Roseanne Cash, and they're not the same person. I mean, you knew that. But Roseanne, when I talked to Roseanne, she said, tell Rosie, that Rosie was worried, said, my goodness, they've done it again. They've got me. There's Rosie Cash.
And John
said,
knows that, then.
He knows, you're right.
Merle, you got a hit record?
I think so.
Good.
If he's not, he's going to have any minute.
If I don't have, I should have.
Highwayman's number one this week, you know.
I know it did. I really like it, too. Let me tell you that that's the best record I've heard you guys do together.
Remember? Remember me? Well, I got to tell this on Merle. Willie Nelson and Merle Haggard and I were in a hotel room in California. Just about the time this record was released, we were talking and about the potential of it. You know, the four of us singing together, Willie, Waylon, Chris, and I. And Merle said, my record's number one this week. And me and Willie looked at each other, and Willie said, Merle, me and Johnny don't care. In so many words, he said that. I've kind of paraphrased it.
Sincerely, I sincerely do like your record.
Thank you. I like your recordings, too.
That's handy.
He said he liked my recordings, too.
I heard Sing Me Back Home on the radio yesterday. I remember the first time I ever heard that. We were in Bakersfield. We'd done a show, and we went by your house.
Yeah.
And that's about the time you carried in your last bag of groceries.
Yeah.
When Sing Me Back Home was released and hit real big for you.
John was kind enough to take me aside and get me all straightened out with the public on an issue concerning the San Quentin thing. You asked me to be honest with the public and mm-hmm. let them know that I'd had problems early in my life. You said it'll keep your name out of the or something like that.
Yeah, but the thing about it is when you came out and told all about it and were honest about it, the people loved you for it. Didn't you love him
yes,
for it?
Yes, they are.
Thank you.
Well, listen, I'll tell you what we would like to do right now. Helen's son, David, is here, David Carter Jones, and he has written a song that I think is a beautiful thing. It was written especially for Mama Maybelle Carter, and since David wrote it, he's going to do it for us tonight, and I think we'll just take a few minutes and think about Mother Maybelle Carter.
All right.
Maybelle, lady that we love so well, well, she meant the world to me. And still sometimes, when I'm feeling all alone, well, she's right there with me. And even though she's gone to better days, that won't dry the tears from my face. Maybe, lady with a song to say, well, I heard them all for free. She'd drive all night, ask her if she felt all right. She'd say, don't worry for me. I wish I could turn back time and
It's gonna be colder without her sunshine. It's with her songs we could always sing along. She made a place for me. So long, gentle lady, oh so strong, like the wind in from the sea. I'll always be safe in your grace, your blue eyes, the smile on your face. Maybe, lady that we love so well, she meant the world to me. And even now, when I'm feeling all alone, I begin to see that she'll be standing side, and he's gonna dry all the tears from her eyes. Maybe,
maybe,
maybe.
The Foolin' with TG Sweepstakes is brought to you by TNN and Kmart Stores.
We have a brand new duet for you, and I think you're going to enjoy this. There's a tall, long, lanky man dressed in black with his new guitar player. Here is Johnny and Merle.
Kick it off there.
I hear the train a-coming. It's rolling around the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. I'll pick it, Merle. But that train keeps a-rolling on down to San Antone. Pick it, Merle.
Terrific. We'll be right back. Okay, we've got an old Carter family song, and John, if you'll try it, here is the banks of the Ohio, and this is everybody, we hope.
And only say that you'll be mine, in no other's arms entwined, down beside. Well, I ask my love to take a walk with me a little ways. And as we walked along, we talked of when would be our wedding day. And only say,
against her breast, and told her she was going to rest. And she cried, Willie, don't murder me. I'm not prepared for eternity. And only say that you'll be mine,
that you'll be mine.
And no other's arms entwined, down beside where the waters flow, down by the banks of the Ohio. Started home between 12 and 1. I cried, my God, what have I done? I've murdered the only girl I love, because she would not be my bride.
And only say,
only say
that you'll be mine,
that you'll be mine.
Tommy Cash especially, Rosie, Helen, Merle Haggard, and Freddie back here, John McEwen and David and Johnny Cash. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming, all the great band back here. And we'll just sing about it.
And a